So I made it up. They put it on there. Okay. Native American people on the census, they have been identified as free. They have been identified as colored. They have been identified as Indian. They have been identified as non-white. So if you want to figure out your blood and to figure out whether you can receive federal acknowledgement for being a part of a certain Native American tribe, then you have to use some form of documentation to figure out how that is the case. But there is none. There's very little documentation. And if for whatever reason you are a part of a Native American group that has been exiled in a particular area and your documentation and everything you own was taken away, right? Then you don't have access to that information. I remember my father, he decided that he was gonna sell my grandmother's dining room set. But all the family pictures was in the armoire. All the family pictures were in the armoire. So he sold somebody our entire history. All the pictures, thousands of pictures and all the things, I don't care, I just need money, you know. Sell this, get this crack. You know, he sold our entire family history, you know, for profit. You know, it's crazy. And so when you don't have items to prove who you are, then you're stuck, you understand? You don't know who you are. You can't find out who you are. And the thing is, some people never have to think about that. You know, they have to think about that. Well, who's my great, great, great grandparents? You know, where did they come from? You know, I want to know what foods we ate. I want to know, you know, I want to know where I got this talent from, or, you know, if this is hereditary. You know, some people have the ability to just ask a question to your grandparents or to look at a photo book or, you know, to have some chair that was, you know, built by your great-grandmother or your grandfather, or do you understand what I'm saying? Like, you have historical artifacts about your culture. You own these things. You can touch them. You can feel them. But there are people in the United States who don't have anything. They can't even go back and die. History, because it's a social construction, and because they were marginalized, and now they can't do that. So you understand, it is truly a privilege to know about your history, but it's just something that some people don't have to think about. You don't have to think about it, you know, because it's already given to you. It is the given that you can ask a question or learn about recipes or just know things that some people don't have the ability to gain knowledge about. So the United States government recognizes 317 American Indian tribes. And I want you to understand that there were millions of Native American tribes. But now, 317. So, this property that you're on right now, this desk that you're writing on, the chair that you're in, and this building, and this space, this belonged to somebody else. But we don't even acknowledge that even because of our privilege. You know, this space belonged to someone else. It was a part of someone else's history. But we don't acknowledge that in conversation because it wasn't our fault. Because nobody here did it. I didn't do it. You didn't do it, right? But it's just something to think about, right? Something to think about. So here are some examples of the largest tribes. And maybe you've heard of some of these, right? You've heard of some of these. But again, there are about 317, so about 10 that nobody really acknowledges or talks about, who have, you know, their own government, their their own land, their own laws, rules, and regulations in a sovereign entity. But do you know that? Do you know that there are spaces in the United States where Native Americans own the land and property and they have their own government, their own rules and regulations? But did you know there were 317 spaces? So, this is really interesting. When you start combining racial and then ethnic identity, and then thinking about perhaps what you want to or who you want to identify with. So, my grandfather's family was Native American. I don't tell anybody that I'm half Native American. People can tell something's up with my funny eyes, like something's weird, or eyes change colors, that's kind of strange, that's not really black, right? Something's going on there, you know, I don't know. You know, the people who are closest to me, they know, like when we're doing things together, and they're like, oh my goodness, your eyes just change colors, that's crazy, you know? Like we'll be talking, and my eyes will be dark brown, and all of a sudden they'll have like, gray and different colors in it. Like if I get really excited and then my eyes start changing color. Like, what is that all about? Maybe that's the Native American background. I don't know. Ah! Yeah, I don't know, right? But self-identification is really important. We were just talking about self-identification in my last class. We were talking about how some African American people, middle class in particular, perhaps they're choosing to not identify with this stereotype that all these black people are living in deplorable conditions and going through all of these elements of stress and strain. Like, well, you're not talking about me, you know, right? Who do you identify with? You all remember Raven Simone? Do you remember she's like, man, I'm not dealing with that, you know. I'm Raven. Okay, I'm not identifying with this nonsense, you know. There's a reality here. This is that 1.8 million individuals self-identify, right, as Native American, right? And then 20% report no affiliation. Can you imagine having the opportunity to report no affiliation to a group that has been marginalized, you know? If you can just say N.A., you know, how many people would just be like, N.A., you know, are you black, N.A., you know. I don't want to identify with history. I don't want to identify with this treatment. I don't want to identify with the history of being marginalized, you know. I don't want somebody to say my name and then connect it to something that is unlike me. There were even some African Americans in the 1980s who said, we don't really want to vote for affirmative action policy because I don't want somebody saying that I got this job because I was black. I got this job because I'm an intelligent, knowledgeable human being. I got this job because I worked hard for it, because I deserve it. I don't want there to be a policy out there where somebody thinks that I only got this job because somebody handed it to me because of the color of my skin, right? So when you talk about self-identification, obviously Native Americans is a great example, you know. Wow, you know, 20% report no tribal affiliation, another 20% report mixed heritage, right? And 60% of them are reporting self-identifying as Native American. But that's gotta be rough to have 20% who just say, I'm not connecting with this. That's tough. It's tough, you know what I mean? And the thing is, if you don't have to think about something like that and what that feels like to say, I'm not gonna identify with the people who look like me, the people from my culture, you know, maybe you don't understand it, you know? Maybe you don't get it. But imagine having to reject your historical identity or feeling that you need to reject your historical identity in order to get ahead or move forward or perhaps to be successful. I remember my grandmother talking to me about my great grandma and how she would buy this makeup that was a traditional white woman's skin color. And she would put this makeup on and she would walk miles to work to another community. And she could not tell anybody where she lived or anything like that. She had to pass. Have you ever heard that before? She had to pass as white so that she could earn a living for her family. And she made much more money than my great-grandfather. But she made that money because she was able to reject who she was and to be somebody else, to be totally someone else in order to make sure that she could feed her children. So, I mean, think about the children in Jamaica, the many children who are dying from skin cancer because they're bleaching their skin because they believe that if they have darker skin, then they will not have economic mobility. They will not be able to get a job. They will not be accepted into colleges. They have to reject the patois language and to learn British English and change how they speak, change how they look, so that society will accept them because they were born with the wrong color. They were born in the wrong ethnic group. And having to think about that every day. There's so many things that some people don't have to think about every day. Can you imagine if perhaps you had to think about some of these things every day, or you had to change the way you look every day to fit in? And some of you do. You wear so much makeup, you don't even know who you are. You take it off. Who is that? Girl from my class. Oh, I would have never recognized her with all that makeup. Right? Makeup is one way. Changing your language is one way. Changing the way you dress is one way, you know. But people have to negotiate these identities every day. Every day, some people have to think about these things before they get ready to leave. And they have to think about how people are going to treat them every day. Every day, before they make the long list of the things that they have to do before they leave. And everybody in here has to negotiate different identities, and everybody has to negotiate something. But what we're talking about right now is ethnicity. Does everybody understand that? So what I don't want you to say is, well, I got shit going on, I got problems. You know, well, everybody's got problems, you know. But we're trying to move ourselves out of our everyday life box, and we're trying to think about, you know, perhaps what happens when you have to negotiate realities that maybe other people just don't have to deal with. And how maybe tough that can be sometimes in a society that has socially constructed or created this. This has been created. And it's still here. It's not gone, it's still here. What people don't understand is that it takes about 15 years or so, maybe 15 or 20 years, to really see the outcome of policy formation. So what I need you to understand is that if the civil rights movement occurred in 1964 and in 1965, it took about 15 years for people to start applying those policies. So in 1980 is when you started seeing some women and African Americans and other ethnic groups, you see them beginning to have jobs and to participate in the workforce, right? How many people here have parents that were born in the 80s, 70s? Do you understand that this stuff happened like a generation away? Race relations in the United States, the civil rights movement spraying people with water hoses and dogs sicking and all the videos that people saw that people think happened so long ago. Do you have any idea that this stuff just happened yesterday? Does anybody remember high school? Unfortunately, how fast is time going? Time goes really fast. So if you think about how fast time moves, as you all grow a little bit older, you'll realize that 10 years is like, oh my goodness, yesterday. And I look at all these wrinkles on my hands. What happened? My hands used to be so smooth. I put my hands next to my daughter's hands. I just got a shirt that got this thing on it. I'm gonna have to look at it. I got a new shirt now. I'll have to look at any wrinkles on my hand. I got little special holes, and I have to look at it anymore because 10 years just went by so fast. And yeah, exactly. I have to look at it. No more. It's gone. That's the reality. If you don't want to see something, just get a new shirt. It just happened. And so people are like, why are all these people tripping about race relations? It's no more racism. All these people are crazy. People were just able to go to college. You understand? When my daughter did the report, and she's talking about this, these numbers of African-American people in the field, there are people getting a first degree in physics in 1985. This is what you all need to understand, is that when people are talking about race relations and different dynamics in society, this is not old stuff. So this is why people are so pissed off. This is why people are so angry right now, because this is just a generation away. And people have to recognize that. You have to understand, it's no level playing field. It's not a level playing field. We have just started altering race relations in the United States. This has just begun. It's one of me here. I'm the only black female faculty member at Shepherd University. One, right here. We are just getting started. We are just getting started. There may be adjunct faculty, part-time faculty, but I'm a full-time faculty member, and it's just one. You know, not talking about how many Hispanic female faculty members are there. None! Zero! No! So this is what I need you all to understand. And so this process that has occurred, I'm going to connect it to something called colonialism, right? I'm going to tell you that the United States is responsible for race relations. Does everybody understand that? I'm going to tell you that our government is responsible for race relations. And what I need you to do is just drink the Kool-Aid and then assess it, think about it more critically later. Okay? Our government is responsible for the way people treat each other. They are responsible. And you know who else is responsible now as a result? You. You are responsible for the way you choose to treat other people. Because there was a time when there weren't rules and regulations that would allow everybody to be accepted and treated as if they were human beings and as if they were normal. But that's not the case anymore. Now, today, you can treat anybody with respect. You can treat everybody with respect if you want to. If you want to. And so, just like with Native Americans, there were points in time when our government decided we're going to let Native Americans have sovereign entity. So we're going to give all of them land. We're going to give them reparations. We're going to give them money. We're going to give them land, right? We're going to give them certificates. They did this, right? But then in 1871, they said, nah, we don't want to do that anymore. Because we need the land that they're occupying. Does everybody understand that? So they decided that they would destroy tribal sovereignty and end rights to negotiate treaties. You understand? What happens here, what you have to understand, is that when the government decides that, you know, we're going to help people and then we're not going to help people. We're going to do this for people, then we're not going to do this for people. These things affect lives. This affects lives, but this has been happening for years. Does everybody understand that? It has been happening that certain groups are allowed privileges, and they get a taste of it. They feel what it's like to move forward. They feel like what it's like to have rights. And then, right, when politics shifts hands, right, then some of those rights and privileges are then taken away. is important to think about, right? This is very important to think about. Thinking about the power and the privilege of laws and rules and regulations and government, and understanding that those politics, those laws and rules and regulations actually affect lives. This is what I need you to understand. That it's not as silly as a vote. It's about what happens with lives. That's what matters. And you all make those choices. You are the new generation, the next generation. And we have to understand that with every choice we make, those choices impact lives. Not just your life, because you're in an individual society where you all are thinking about me. Most people are thinking about me. What's going to happen to me? What's going to happen to my pocketbook? But when we make these choices affect the lives of all of these people around us, those people we can see and those people we cannot see. And so we have to talk about that. We have to talk about the power of the government and how when we're so overjoyed about a win or we're so defeated about a win, that at the end of the day, all of this stuff that we're talking about, it affects lives, people. And that's what everybody should be thinking about today, right? That's what people should be thinking about today. People shouldn't be thinking about whether somebody won or lost a campaign. They should be thinking about how lives will be affected and how we need to work together collectively to make sure that we aren't defeating certain populations and taking away from their progress. That's what we should be talking about. Not talking about nasty things about people's character or, you know, something random about how somebody is dressed or somebody's attitude. We should be focusing on the progress that has been made for certain marginalized groups and making sure that we can do something, you understand, to keep as many people free as possible, as free as possible. Because your rights are just as important as your rights, and your rights are as important as your rights, right? But why are we dealing with so much pettiness, right? Instead of figuring out how collectively we can come together to solve our problems. But this is what we're doing, you understand? But what we're doing, again, there's the power dynamics, right? And you talk about colonialism, that is the power of a government, you understand, to take an entire ideology and to take people and to control and manage how those people can exist in a space and what they're capable of doing. And then to use that ideology to push you all into that same mindset so that people begin to fail and continue to fail. And you have to be aware of this process. It can be called a brainwash, it can be called a reality or anything. But the idea here is that this situation now is not about an election at all. It's about lives. About lives. Lives of people who matter, people who are important, people who are just as valuable as everybody in this classroom. That's what everybody should be thinking about. That's what I think we should be thinking about. We should be thinking about progress. Right? And not somebody's attitude problem or their temperament. Not saying that those things aren't important. They are very important. But lives, that's something that we constantly ignore in the United States. And we've watched people die. And we've actually single-handedly killed people for progress, for economic progress in particular. It has been a goal for the United States to grow as a superpower. And in that process, millions of people have died. The question just becomes, how many people do you all think should die? So culture is very important. All right, so culture is this system where it has much to do with, you know, how we love, right, what we love, what we think about, what's valuable or important to us. Your culture could also relate to how you think, what you do on a regular basis, how you choose to interact or communicate with other people. Culture is vague. It's very vague. So I'm going to talk to you for a few minutes about some happened with Native American culture and perhaps how culture is being compromised, right? So think about it. Most of the Native American cultures revolved around using natural resources, like using, you know, fishing or hunting. But when the United States decided to take away land from most Native American populations, they moved those Native American groups to desert land and then took the viable resources that they had so that we can grow and so that we can become, you know, economically viable. So imagine someone taking you from this wonderful land of West Virginia and moving you to the desert, and then you have to figure out how you're going to eat. You know, you're used to growing crops, but the land is totally different. You know, what are you going to do? Well, some of the options have been gambling or gaming. But keep in mind that some tribes have opted not to participate, right? Because the gambling conflicts in its entirety their cultural practices, their religious or spiritual beliefs, right? So they've decided not to do it. Would you do it? Would you decide to let someone build a facility on your property? Not your property, but, you know, you think it's your property. To build it on your property and have unlimited alcohol drinking, right? As long as people are paying. So that your community can earn a percentage of the profit from that practice. So if you were extremely religious, would you let someone do something outside of your spiritual beliefs to better your family or to improve the conditions in your community? What are you willing to sacrifice so that your family can eat? I remember, do you all have a god brother or a god sister? Or is this such a black thing? I don't really know. You all think this is real? I just need to make sure it's real before. Okay. I don't know. My mother may have made it up, you know. I have several god sisters, okay? So my god sister says to me, she says, "You might think bad of me, but I really want this McDonald's. So I'm gonna go on a date with this guy." And you know where this goes. She said, "I gotta taste." At this time, it was, you all are not old enough for a McDLT. Have you ever heard of that sandwich, a McDLT? Anyway, raise your hand if you've ever heard of a McDLT before. Did you know what a McDLT is? Okay, it's just us again. It's only us. It's a McDLT. So it was. This is when McDonald's used styrofoam containers. They'll probably use them again next year. But one side of the sandwich was hot, and the other side was cold. So they had a big, long container, kind of like the hotcakes container, and it was kind of like this. And they would put the hamburger and the bun on one side, and they would put like the lettuce and tomato and cheese on, or whatever, on the other side, and it was the McDLT. So my sister really wanted a McDLT, but she didn't have any money. She said, "You know what I'm gonna do for this McDLT? I'm gonna have sex with this guy and buy me a McDLT." She said, "Well, he's hot anyway. I know some of you have done it. You can't trick me. You wanna do it tomorrow, Thanksgiving. I have a Thanksgiving dinner. I'm calling this guy. We're gonna go to Kazoo." Anyway, because your standards are higher now. You get different standards, you know. McDonald's is not good enough. You know, spring rolls and sushi, it's on, right? I mean, I'm going somewhere with this. You know, I mean, the thing is, like, you know, people will have sex for potato chips. So maybe you expect people to sacrifice their entire culture for gambling and gaming. I mean, I think people don't even think about perhaps the value, the spiritual value of Native American culture and of the sacrifices that have to be made so that their people have food to eat. Think about it like this. If the government lets you borrow land and you're not allowed to sell this land, but a business wants to come, you want a business to come to you. But you don't own the property. You can't sell them the property. How many businesses are going to want to set up shop on Native American land, set up shop in a building that they don't belong, right? And have their business there, who's gonna do that? And what bank is gonna give somebody a loan to start a business, you know, and property, you know, on a property, a manufacturing business even, on property that you don't own? So the possibilities for growth on these Native American spaces is like, it's rough to even get a business who is able to get a loan, right? To set up shop on this land. So they're stuck with options like gaming where, you know, a big business, elite people will invest in this casino, you understand? And then their family members can earn, you know, benefits, you know? So everybody gets a percentage of the profit from the casino, but you have to sacrifice your integrity, your culture, so that people can eat because they can't create viable businesses for people to have the jobs that they need. And all they're trying to do is kind of re-envision and revisit what they started off with that was taken away. But, you know, again, it may be difficult for us in this room since we'll have sex for a barbecue rib. You know, it's really difficult for us to process how challenging it is for an entire culture to have to make such huge sacrifices in order to feed their families. You know, what are you all having to sacrifice to go to college? Mm-hmm. Having a good bank account. Mm-hmm. Your sanity.
Yeah, it is crazy. Yeah, I attribute it to that. I know that example is crazy.
You don't have to sacrifice your family.
You don't have to sacrifice your family. Well, you're working for your family, right? You're trying to build a future. You're trying to educate yourself. You're trying to empower yourself. You're going to school right now to empower yourself. You're not going to school to sacrifice your culture. Maybe you are. Maybe you're sacrificing your culture. Maybe. I sacrificed my culture. I told you that already. Sorry. No. Yeah. I love my people. Right? But I'm not going to live in the ghetto ever again. I don't want to. I don't want to. We talked about savage culture already, right? We talked about that already a little bit, right? But the point we make with Native American culture is this idea of conversion, right? This idea that if you're not a part of my religion, you with me? If you don't believe what I believe, and if you choose not to convert, I'm going to kill you. Oh my goodness, is that familiar? Oh my goodness, did we just go back in time or what? You know what? We never left. We've been doing this all along. If you don't conform, if you don't abandon your habits and accept my customs that are civilized, then I'm going to kill you. And everybody here is going to be okay with it because it's just how we do things. It's just how we do things. It's how we've done things. If you don't do what I want you to do, I will incarcerate you, I will kill you, right? I will take your children. Yeah, I will take your life. And nobody here is gonna have a problem with it because it's how we do things. This is rough, see, the thing about it is a lot of people, now you're pissed off at me now. You were laughing a few minutes ago, but now everybody's mad at the truth. Everybody's angry because we believe so deeply in our process, which we should, but at the same time, we have to acknowledge what is really happening. What is really happening? It's the truth, right? It's not a lie, but we don't want to talk about it, you see. We don't want to talk about things like this. It makes us very uncomfortable. It makes us very uncomfortable. But sometimes when people aren't doing what we need them to do, we feel threatened, we are afraid, and we feel like we need to protect or save, right? Or keep whole what it is that we have. And some people believe, in fact, that this is all that they have, that all you have is your culture. All you have is your identity, right? Your name is who you are, right? That's why in some countries, if a woman is raped, they might kill her because the family's name has been sacrificed. Honor killings. Yeah? Because what you are proud of is your family and that history and our country. But in that process of being proud, we kill people. We kill people to protect and to serve what we believe in, our culture. And anybody who is unlike us, in some points of history, and I think after the news yesterday, I think here, if you don't do it like us, you are a savage. If you don't do it the way we do, we might kill you. We might kill you. That's scary. Is it scary? Is it a little scary? It's scary to me. Well, really, because I don't look like a lot of people, and I don't want to die. You know, that's one thing, you know. But I feel okay. But this is something to think about. See, this class today is all about thinking. Thinking about everything, right? And so, who should live and who should die? Who should migrate and who should? These are things you should think about, you understand, right? How many people here are white Anglo-Saxon Protestants? You know, the first ancestors of the first folks who rolled over here on the boat. You all migrated here from a different place, right? And so who should tell you that you shouldn't be here? Because you came here, right? Some legally, some illegally, huh? It gets rough, right? It's tough. It's very tough. If we talk about history, then it becomes very, very challenging because then we have to acknowledge that what certain groups have privilege and other groups do not. But it's just stuff to think about. We have to think about this stuff. We have to think about it. Who deserves to be here and who doesn't? These are things that you all have to think about because in the next couple years, you have to make votes, right? You have to vote about things, and this is very important. If someone deserves to be an American, should it be because they are just like you? Or can they be different? Still so quiet in here. I'm gonna move the slide. Maybe this one is better. Nope, it's not. Okay. So the next slide is about integration and conformity. So check this out. I remember I went to an integrated school. So this was a school where they drove African-American people on a school bus about 25 minutes to get to a school in a not so African-American community at all. Not so African-American at all. And so we had to go to school with these people who hated us. These people hated us so bad that people wouldn't even look at me in the classroom. I remember, I was like, you know, I'm the same as looking. Hi! You know, they didn't even look at me. You know, they didn't even look at me at all, right? And so they had the desks, like, black person, white person, black person, white person. Can you imagine if we just kind of tell everybody to leave? And today when we come back to class next time, I want to be boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, all around. This is so disturbing, you know what I mean? Like, it was such a disturbing situation, you know. But I remember I got a spanking in the car one day with jumper cables. You know what jumper cables are? Oh my God, I remember this so clearly. You all bring everything back to me. My grandmother was pissed off because I didn't know how to get to my school. And I remember we had a hole in the back of our car floor. It was like you could like burn a rubble, like it was a hole. It's a hole you put your foot down. And we didn't have seatbelts either. I'm just telling my age. Thought I looked, tried to make myself look younger. Anyway, so we didn't have any seatbelts, and there was a hole in the floor of the car. I remember it all coming back to me. And I remember my grandmother was furious because I was, you know, 7 years old, and I didn't know the directions. I didn't know how to get to this school where people were mean to me. That's my memory. That's my memory about school integration. So this happened to Native American people, too. They were forced to go to public schools. They were pulled from their sovereign entity spaces and forced to go to school, just like I was. Just like I was as well. I'll tell you about uncomfortable. Being a little kid and going into a space where everybody hates you. Have you ever had to walk into a room? Ladies, have you ever walked into a room and there were three people you slept with in the room?
No.
Yes. I can't say that I have. Somebody's like, oh yeah, that happened to me. That was so awkward. I'm just kidding. Somebody's like, I'm telling you, somebody's here like, oh my goodness. Now I just had a memory. There was a hole in the bottom of the car. Anyway. I'm telling you, talk about an uncomfortable situation to be a baby. You understand? To be a baby. So you know what it's like. Do you all remember when you were seven? Not really. See, the thing is, what's sad is when you have memories as a seven-year-old and they're not good memories. You know what I mean? That's tough. When you have a memory from seven and it's bad, like some jumper cables. That was crazy. No, she was pissed. How are you riding to school every day? How many school days is it in a school year? I don't even know. She probably made a number up. You riding to school 150 days, and you don't know how to get to your school. Whap, jumper cable. I told the people at the school, she got in trouble. I was that kid. Yeah, I told them. She beat me with the jumper cable. Marginalized, that racism isn't a polarized concept of black versus white. that there are a variety of different groups of people who are treated very differently because of the color of their skin, because of the food that they eat, because of their cultures, because of the way they talk, because of their religion. I can tell you that we are divided on so many fronts, and only your generation is the generation that has policies and laws and rules and regulations that say you shouldn't treat people like this. The generation before, those policies and processes, they were federal mandates that states had to live up to and change their policies. But this generation right here, you are the generation that can change things, and you're the generation that can make a difference, but you don't know that because somebody told you that race relations was 5 billion years ago. Like it was so long ago that nobody can remember what happened when my grandfather told me that he watched his little brother get tied to the back of a car and watch his brains splatter out in the middle of the road. And nobody was convicted. Because he was just a little Negro boy. Maybe he looked at somebody the way he shouldn't have. That happened 65 years ago. But it happened to my grandfather's brother, right? That's all I have to tell you about this, you know. I have to tell you that you got the PowerPoints here, and you can take the time to read through it, and you have the power of knowledge. You can learn about these situations and these conditions. Make yourself aware of what is happening, because sometimes when something is not right in front of you, and you can't see it, you can't touch it, you can't feel it, then it's not real to you. It's not really happening. Because nobody in the media is going to tell the full truth about the things that have happened to ethnic minorities in the United States